I would tell an aspiring kid that dreams are nothing more than plans awaiting action. And sometimes you may be the only person that can see your vision. Quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson, it says, "Do not go where the path may lead. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail."
Eastbrook Dental provides the most advanced dental treatments available. Pinhole treatment for gum regrowth. Certified Botox therapy for migraines, tension headaches, or TMJ. Get a free consultation or a new patient $99 special that includes cleaning, x-ray, and comprehensive consultation. 0% financing is available. Book your appointment online at eastbrookdental.com or call 248-449-8000.
Your smile, your health, your happiness is our priority.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Hi, I'm Kurt David, joined by our guest today, two-time Super Bowl champion, Charlie Batch. Charlie, thanks for being on the show.
Not a problem. Thank
you.
So
if it wasn't for football, what sport would it have been?
For me, it would have been basketball. I mean, it was something that I really loved doing the most. It was easy to do. You can do it every day. And, that was something that I really took to at an early age.
Were you tall enough? Was it one of those that you had enough skills, you think?
I think that was the easiest game that everyone can play together. Mm-hmm. I mean, you didn't need 11 people or maybe 22 people to play football. It was something that, you know, anyone can participate, and we stayed on the basketball course for hours.
But football was the one. I mean, you had some opportunities as a result. And that was the sport that you found the most opportunity. One of those being Eastern Michigan University. Mm-hmm. From Homestead, Pennsylvania to Ypsilanti, Michigan. How did that path happen at that time?
It was crazy how it happened. They were there actually to see a teammate of mine, Richard Walker, who's still a childhood friend and still cool with to this day. And literally they were there to see him. And at that point, Coach Tom DePewitt, who was the defensive line coach recruiter of the Western Pennsylvania, he came in and he's looking around. He's like, "Who's that quarterback throwing a ball?" Mm-hmm. And from near, he said, "Who's recruiting him?" Got a chance to talk to him. And he said, "Hey, I would love to bring you up on a visit, bring you to Eastern Michigan." And I'm looking at him. I'm like, "Eastern Michigan, where is that at?"
Where is that at?
And he's like, "It's Ypsilanti. Let's go." You know, he's trying to get me excited. But the moment I got on campus, you know, I fell in love with the campus. And he actually offered me during that time. And I really, really wanted to go to Pitt because it's in my backyard.
Sure.
But, you know, I'm trying to play that waiting game and the way things kind of fail. I didn't want to do that, and I took the offer from Eastern Michigan. And
so the viable offer at that time was Eastern Michigan. One bird in the hand, two in the bush, as they say. But so more importantly, you came to Eastern, had some great success at Eastern. Let's talk about that. What were some of the highlights of your college career?
Well, going having the opportunity to play, that was first and foremost. But I think the biggest game for me was in the end of the season, 1994, we were playing Toledo Rockets. Mm-hmm. The starter just got benched heading into the end of the first quarter. Coach looked at me, said, "You're the guy, let's go." Let him down the field. It was 17-3 at the end of the first quarter. Lo and behold, as the game went on, I ended up throwing a touchdown pass to win it with no time on the clock. Everyone celebrated.
Everybody on the field, all excited.
Everybody on the field. And you know, at that point, that was one of those moments that, you know, from a confidence standpoint, to say, you want to know what? Here I am.
Yeah, new coach change, though, at that point as well. You had a coaching change. And how did that affect you at that point then? Because you thought you might have to prove yourself all over again at Eastern.
Right. It was one of those things to where you're saying to yourself, okay, now here I am. But now the coach leaves. New coach comes in. Rick Rasnick was the head coach. Dan Henson was the offensive coordinator. Mm-hmm. And from there, you don't know what they're thinking. And then from that moment, when they came in, reviewed the film, they said, "We don't need to go get a quarterback. We have our quarterback on the roster." Had that meeting with me and told me, "Hey, it's your show. Moving forward, let's go."
Great success, but also one of the most defining moments of your life happened during that time. I believe it was your senior year or junior year at Eastern Michigan University. You got a phone call from your mother. Can you talk about that phone call and how that affected you at that moment?
Yeah, it was tough. I mean, at that point, you know, I received a phone call from my mother, and she told me that I needed to come home. I didn't know what I was coming home for, didn't know how long I was coming home for. But at that point, she said,
wouldn't tell you what was going on.
She wouldn't tell me. And I said, "Mom, before I get on the road and drive 5 hours, you need to tell me why I'm coming home." And at that point, with the deepest swallow that I've ever heard in my life, she said, "Your sister's been shot and killed." And at that point, I'm just like, what? You know, so now there's a lot of uncertainty. I'm driving home, had no idea what was going on. And, you know, it was tough. It was a tough moment for me and my family. And at that point, I said if I was ever in a position to give back, I would. And because I never wanted another family to feel the way that we did. Danielle was 17 years old. She never had an opportunity to live life. And as the story goes, I mean, she literally was caught in crossfire between rival gangs. And the guy that she was with used her as a body shield. Mm-hmm. And at that point, she was killed instantly. And I said, you want to know what if I'm, you know, I was unsure if I was going back to school because I knew my family needed me at that point. But at the same time, I had a family at Eastern Michigan that needed me as well. So I made that promise to do something in my family that has never been done, and that was to graduate college. So I shifted all my time and energy to number one, graduate. Mm-hmm. I did that in 1997. And then at that point, it was now time to shift focus and hopefully get one of those 32 teams to pay attention to me and hopefully draft me in the NFL draft.
And you did. Fortunately, you did. In fact, it wasn't too far down the road. Detroit Lions picked right. up on you. And talk about that time. You had the time at Detroit. There was some trying times. You played a lot, though. Mm-hmm. You got in there, played a lot. Let's talk about Detroit and your time with the Lions. You came in with Barry. Right. You're thinking Barry Sanders is going to be there for right. you, right?
You think he is going to be there that whole year. That was great because I'm a rookie. I'm wide-eyed. I had no idea what to expect. I was just happy to be on the field. And then, you know, you go through that season and, you know, Barry retires and you're just like, whoa, what's going to happen? But, you know, it's one of those things that, you know, number one, I'm thankful for the opportunity. And I thank the Ford family for believing in me and giving me my opportunity mm-hmm. in the National Football League. You know, and we had some good times, some bad times up there. But unfortunately, as the business goes, you know, my dream didn't necessarily fulfill itself because I wanted to win that championship in Detroit. And for whatever reason, it didn't happen.
Well, three coaches in 3 years, that didn't mm-hmm. help much either. As a quarterback, especially as a quarterback, that's a key position and to be in line with a coach. But the good news is that you went from Detroit to someplace even better for right. you. Let's talk about that. How did that happen? How did you end up from Detroit to Pittsburgh? What was that all
actually,
about?
Actually, you know, at that point, Matt Millen came in, you know, and he figured, okay, we need to go in a different direction. Mm-hmm. And I was okay with that. I mean, for me, I understood where it was. I mean, I was injured a lot, so I wasn't from a durability standpoint, maybe what they were looking for. So they moved in a different direction. I was released, ended up coming to Pittsburgh, and at that point, it was a childhood dream of mine because growing up in Pittsburgh, 5 minutes away from the facility, now here I am wanting to be part of the Steeler organization. When I sit down with Coach Cower at that point, he's like, hey, let's do this.
You know, playing with some players that maybe you even grew up idolizing at that time.
Absolutely. I mean, you're playing with Jerome Bettis. My locker was next to Jerome Bettis. And mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, so I couldn't be a fan, you know, because he was my teammate, but I had to play it cool. Mm-hmm. You know, but it was cool. You know, I had a chance to play with Jerome, Hines Ward, some great players. That ultimately Ben Roethlisberger, as he's here, you know, Troy Polamalu, those guys, you know, they are all here. But for me to put that uniform on, it was a dream come true for me. And of course, I looked at myself quite a few times in the mirror to make it sure that it was real that I was putting on the black and gold.
We need to take a break, but when we come back, I'm going to ask Charlie to share the hardest hit he's ever taken as a quarterback. Stay with us.
I'm Farron Scott.
I'm Steve Scott of the Scott Group.
As a military veteran family, we understand veteran home buying programs.
We are one of only 80 military relocation professionals in Michigan.
We provide strategic, low-cost ideas to maximize your home sale value.
Plus, guide you through the process of purchasing a home with easy zero-down veteran home loan programs. That's right, zero-down home loan.
Call us today at 833-SCOTT-MI or visit us at scottgroupmi.com.
Get moving with the Scott Group.
Looking to build a new pool or spa? Need to maintain your pool area to optimal condition? Trust the experts at AquaGuard Pool Services. With over 30 years of experience, you can rest assured that you will have the best pool and spa. From design to construction, AquaGuard Pool Services can provide a comprehensive analysis to give you the perfect pool system. Call AquaGuard Pool Service at 248-787-4522. You'll be glad you did.
Eastbrook Dental provides the most advanced dental treatments available. Pinhole treatment for gum regrowth. Certified Botox therapy for migraines, tension headaches, or TMJ. Get a free consultation or a new patient $99 special that includes cleaning, x-ray, and comprehensive consultation. 0% financing is available. Book your appointment online at eastbrookdental.com or call 248-449-8000.
Your smile, your health, your happiness is our priority.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Hi, I'm Kurt David, joined by our guest, Charlie Batch. Charlie, what was the hardest hit as a quarterback? You have 11 guys chasing you. What was the hardest hit you've ever taken as an NFL quarterback?
The one I remember is, I remember being in Detroit, we were playing the San Diego Chargers. And of course, Junior Seau sitting right there, and I'm looking, and I see Rodney Harrison from the left side. I change protections. I'm thinking I'm protected. I end up dropping back, and lo and behold, nobody picked up from a communication standpoint.
The
blind side. Rodney Harrison knocked the heck out of me.
Knocked the wind out of you? What did it feel like?
I mean, I literally laid on the ground a little longer, and I'm like, you got to be kidding me. I knew I changed protections to make sure that he was protected. And that's the hardest part from a quarterback standpoint. When you know you're going to get hit, you can brace for the hit. Mm-hmm. But whenever you think you're protected, you stand in the pocket, relax, and those are the ones that hurt.
And sure enough, it hurts you. But the good news is that moving forward again back to Pittsburgh, that you had a chance to play with some great players, great teams, two Super Bowl championships. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about those. What do you remember best, you know, the first one, the second one? What do you remember best?
Well, the first one obviously is the one that I remember the most because it was such a large gap between the last time that the Super Bowl winners from the 70s mm-hmm. versus the one that we were going through in 2005 season, because they did lose the 95 Super Bowl to Dallas. So, you know, when you're going through that championship run, of course, there's a lot of pressure. They want you to win. And whenever you have really 52 guys going through for the same common goal, and I say 52 because there was only one guy, Willie Williams, that was on the 95 Super Bowl team, but they lost. Mm. But when you have everyone kind of going together, never been to a Super Bowl and wanting to go
hungry.
Through, they're hungry for it. Yeah. It was a special moment because we knew that that was going to be Jerome's last season. Mm. He made it known, aired it out in a mm-hmm. team meeting, and we knew we were trying to accomplish something special for him.
So that made it more special for you. So out of the two, that was the most special because of the time as well as Jerome.
And not to mention going back to Detroit and winning it there too.
That always helps. But let's talk about the second one then, because you did have some time and some emphasis with that as far as having a Super Bowl is nothing to sneeze at. What did that mean to you the second time around?
Oh, the second time around, I mean, you kind of get used to what that feeling could look like, mm-hmm. but because it's the year after, we didn't even make the playoffs. Mm-hmm. So when you get to that point now, new coach coming in, you're still trying to prove yourself. We knew we had the goods, and we say that a lot. Talent around us was really good. And at that point, it was just a matter of putting it all together. Mm-hmm. We had the toughest schedule at that point, and now putting it all together and making that run. And when you do so, you know, we finished that season 12-4, and you having home playoff games. And when you get to that Super Bowl in Tampa, you know, of course, people were downing because we were playing Arizona. They thought it was going to be a cakewalk, and lo and behold, in the middle of that fourth quarter, we turned out losing that game. And next thing you know, now we had to put a drive together to go out there and win that game. And whenever you saw Ben Roethlisberger throw that pass to Santonio Holmes, I looked at it, and I'm like, I think he got in. They called it in, and then at that point, whenever the officials made it correct, and they said, you want to know what, after review, the call on the field stands.
Changed everything.
Man, it changed everything,
yeah,
man.
Changed
we celebrated
everything.
Like we were rookies all over again.
And so you know, we talk about professional athletes, and 100% of professional athletes ultimately lose their job.
Mm-hmm.
Undeniable facts.
Absolutely.
And 2012 was the last start that you ever had as an NFL mm-hmm. quarterback. Special game against the Baltimore Ravens. Did a great job, you had a great run. What did that game mean to you? But then also knowing that you kind of knew in advance that might be your last start ever.
Right, I knew Ben Roethlisberger was coming back. He missed three previous games prior to that. I was able to start two of them. And knowing that he was coming back, it was like, this may be my last opportunity to ever start in a National Football League. But the stakes were high. Baltimore had a chance to possibly win that division if they won that game. And then at that point, you know, doing something that had never been done, and that was beating Baltimore without Ben Roethlisberger. So, you know, it was stacked against us, but to go in there and really put a final drive together, 6 minutes and 51 seconds, not that
for hour. You especially, because
yeah.
you knew you were towards the end of your career, 38
Absolutely.
Years old.
Absolutely.
I mean, as a quarterback, 38 years in the NFL, it's not a young chicken anymore.
Right, and you have to go down and really get to that point of mm-hmm. putting a drive together, and whenever you beat the Super Bowl, eventually Super Bowl champions
yes.
in their house, you know, it was a special moment.
So at what point did you realize and what point did you know that that transition was going to happen for you, that you were going to be done with pro football?
Well, here I was at year number 15, at 38 years old, mm-hmm. and an expiring contract. That combination right there,
yeah.
that you know, I knew that was going to be it. But for me, it was just a matter of understanding really what the end game was for me. Mm-hmm. I knew at some point I wasn't, you know, I'm not going to play sports forever,
mm-hmm.
and sports will bypass all of us at some mm-hmm. point. So it was important for me to really start that transition, and I kept myself busy in the off season preparing for that moment.
How did you do that? What did you do to prepare for that transition?
Well, number one, I continued to educate myself. Mm-hmm. I took advantage of the NFL business entrepreneurship classes, mm-hmm. so I took classes at University of Penn, at the Wharton Business School. I went to Harvard. I went to Northwestern. I went to Stanford. Went to Notre Dame.
What kind of classes? What were you taking?
These were entrepreneurship classes. So a lot of them focused on different things. So for instance, Wharton would focus on real estate. Then you might have Northwestern, which they're focused on high growth, high entrepreneurship. They want you to become that entrepreneur. So everyone kind of focused a little bit different. Stanford, of course, they're out there in Silicon Valley. They're talking about angel investing and how to approach that. So took a little bit from each. And it was just something that really at that point over the later part of my career, it was just continuing to educate and making sure that I knew what I wanted when I was
So you were preparing. I mean, you did whatever you could to prepare. You were taking advantage of the NFL's offers at that point, too, as far as education. The 90% pay cut that professional athletes take, how did you handle that? What was that like for you?
Yeah, it was different. I mean, it really was. But as you prepare, you're like, okay, you think you're prepared. It wasn't even about the financial aspect. It was more mental. Because I thought I was prepared.
What was the mental aspect?
Because
for
you are now controlled by a coach, they tell you when to show up, when to work out, what to weigh, when
schedule.
To be at training camp. The whole schedule is what they control. And then all of a sudden, because I was so close, you're kind of putting yourself like, oh, it's time to start OTA practice. It's time to report to training camp. Wait a minute. No, it's not. You're not a player anymore. So it was tough to get out of that.
The schedule itself, the time of year,
everything. You build a relationship with the players. You know, now you look at your phone, like, my phone's not ringing anymore.
It's quiet.
Yeah,
it's
and you're
quiet.
Like, well, that technically the guys didn't call when I was playing. They just you already knew what you were doing before you walked out the door. So a lot of that really had to get to really just kind of prepare me to get to that point of understanding, hey, we're going to continue to transition and I'm going to continue to do it.
We're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, I'm going to ask Charlie to share how he became an inspirational speaker.
Genosco Development Company is a real estate development firm specializing in the creation and preservation of quality housing. GDC, through its subsidiaries and joint ventures, engages in the acquisition, development, ownership, and operational oversight of multifamily communities.
GDC aligns itself with a team of experts that believes every property should serve as an economic and social catalyst to the community.
GDC communities are known for their careful planning, attention to detail, and respect for the environment.
Join me, Diana Lewis, and support Detroit Rescue Mission Ministries, which provides emergency shelter, substance abuse counseling, job training, transitional housing, and eventually to those who qualify, a permanent home so they can lead healthy, independent lives. Among those in need, military veterans, women with young children, and families. Please call the number on your screen or go online to drmm.org and donate now.
Eastbrook Dental provides the most advanced dental treatments available. Pinhole treatment for gum regrowth. Certified Botox therapy for migraines, tension headaches, or TMJ. Get a free consultation or a new patient $99 special that includes cleaning, x-ray, and comprehensive consultation. 0% financing is available. Book your appointment online at eastbrookdental.com or call 248-449-8000.
Your smile, your health, your happiness is our priority.
I'm Farron Scott.
I'm Steve Scott of the Scott Group.
As a military veteran family, we understand veteran home buying programs.
We are one of only 80 military relocation professionals in Michigan.
We provide strategic, low-cost ideas to maximize your home sale value.
Plus, guide you through the process of purchasing a home with easy zero-down veteran home loan program. That's right, zero-down home loan.
Call us today at 833-SCOTT-MI or visit us at scottgroupmi.com.
Get moving with the Scott Group.
I'm Kurt David, joined by Charlie Batch. Charlie, post-football, there's lots of options that you had, and some of the options that you took were motivational speaking. Why motivational speaking? What caused you to want to get into that aspect of it?
Well, as my time as an active player, I was a United Way spokesperson, and I was a spokesperson for 6 years. So it allowed me the opportunity to go around different corporations promoting United Way and encouraging support. And when you're talking about a building, talking to over 100 companies, and it just became a natural to me, and that was something that really I started continuing to do because
you realized that you liked it too.
Yeah, I loved it, and it was something that allowed me an opportunity to engage with a lot of good people, and then from there being able to share my story, and a lot of people didn't know some of the things that were going on. And before you know it, my phone line started to continue to blow up. And I'm like, I might will continue to do this professionally if I can. And I've been able to do that thus far, and I love it.
Being called back to your alma mater at Eastern Michigan University to do the commencement speak at the graduation, how special was that for you?
That was humbling. Because
what way?
Because they have so many people to select from. And when my phone rang in January, it was the president. It was Dr. Martin. And I'm thinking she's calling just on the humbug, like she always does. And she's like, no, this one here, I'm asking you as a favor. And I'm like, okay, what's going on? And she said, I would love you to come back to be our commencement speaker. And I kind of looked at my phone and I kind of like, really? Is this the president of the university asking me this?
Where I went to school at?
Yeah, and I'm like, and I kind of didn't want to show my excitement. I was like, when do you need to know by? Even though I could have gave her my answer right there, like, yeah, I would have did it. But I agreed to it. And of course, leading up to that point, you have 3 months to prepare for a speech. And I'm thinking, how am I going to bring it? And I finally felt comfortable enough when I drove up there to tell, okay, I'm ready to deliver the speech. And I sat out there on the stage and I looked around. And I'm like, there's 8,000 people out here. Like, you better keep
at your
alma
mater. This is where you went to school at. You were sitting in that seat at one time.
Yes, I was sitting in that seat. And I'm like, what message am I going to bring to them? And how will they remember, you know, what I said? And I figured out a way to do it. And I thought that I really did it. And President Martin, she was like, thank you. That was
one of your messages at that commencement, was that nobody accomplishes a Super Bowl on their own.
Right.
Who was it for you that helped you in your Super Bowls of life?
Well, really, it was my mom, first and foremost. Mm-hmm. And, you know, anytime that you have the support that way, you know, of course, she followed everything that I've done from the beginning. And to get to that point, but as you go through the NFL, I mean, it's tough. It's not easy all the time. But eventually, I ended up getting to a point where, you know, my wife was one of my rocks as well. You know, she was being there to be able to support and be able to help grow and do some of the things and believe in some of the beliefs that I had off the field. So, you know, I had to quickly find the balance between football and personal. And the minute I got in the house, I wasn't allowed to talk football. She didn't allow
that. It was just Charlie.
You check out.
No kids, but lots of dogs.
Yeah, she says, you're around sports. You're in that building 10 hours a day. You will not come home and talk sports.
Your identity was different at home than it was outside of the
field. She's the one that kept me grounded. But I appreciate her for that. I didn't understand it during that time. You know, but now I'm like, okay, yeah.
What made that difficult for you? It's like, hey, I'm Charlie Batch, or what was that? What made it difficult?
No, because that's all I knew. She's like, no, there's other things going on in this world. Mm-hmm. She's like, what you do, yes, I understand it's your job, but it's just a game. And I'm like, oh, you're right. You know, at the end of it, it didn't matter win or lose on that drive home from the stadium. By the time I got home, she said, I don't care if you lose. I don't care how bad you play. You check out when you walk in this
How
door.
Do you think that helped you?
It helped big time, because it allowed me to separate. It allowed me to separate from the game. It allowed me to keep my sanity, because if I start thinking about and dwelling on some of those
mistakes and what you did,
you miss out on those moments. And she made sure that I didn't miss out on those moments.
So for that case, she is one of your rocks.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We talked about other things that you did, the speaking. You also have a medical company that you are doing very well with right now. Can you tell us a little more about Impellia?
Yes, it's a sports technology company. And really what we do is we focus on the technology, health and wellness. And it's just important for me, because we've been privy as NFL players.
Athletes
player.
The best care.
Yeah, the best care. Yes. And I'm thinking to myself, maybe other people should be able to get their hands on some of these things. And we work directly with universities, and we actually go through and help get to that point of being able to help them manage and get to that point of commercializing their products. And it's just really exciting, because we teamed up with the University of Pittsburgh, we teamed up with Michigan, we teamed up with Columbia. That's just, they're a new partner as well with us. So it's just exciting to really see that different side, but being able to help some of those technologies come to light.
Why is that important to you as a former athlete? Why?
It's important because you have everyday people going through some of the same things that we are going through. You're they're not playing football, but you might have someone just, you know, their
car accident or whatever.
Whatever it may look like from a rehabilitation standpoint, they still have to go through the same things we did. So if we're privy to some of those top technologies, why wouldn't you be able to have access to that? Mm-hmm. So it was important. That's why my partners, they are up in Michigan. Richard Walker, we have Dave Morin. I mean, those guys have been phenomenal to be able to put everything to light. And I enjoy coming back up to Michigan for a lot of our meetings. So it's just special to really see this thing take off.
And your other passion and purpose is your foundation, the Batch Foundation. Let's talk about that. What is it about? What do you do? Why do you do it?
For me, it's special because the impact that we have on kids, we're continuing to push the kids beyond their expectations. And that's the goal of the foundation, because a lot of them, they don't come in with anything, any expectations based off what their surroundings are, what they see outside their door every single day. But for me, it just started because I didn't want my family to go through what we felt. And that's how the whole basis of my sister's memory. And to now, we built it on education. when what we do is draw the kids in with sports, mm-hmm. but then we're able to implement any educational component that we choose. And that's why we are able to focus on reading and computer and reading literacy. Mm-hmm. And that's something that, and as I know I said it reverse, but reading and computer literacy programs, and it's important for us to make sure to let them know that, hey, you need to focus on it. Like I said, sports will be taken away from you, but at some point you can always go back.
And who do you focus on? Who do you try to get in there to do that?
We focus on mainly at age seven. We start at mm-hmm. seven. Sometimes we do have pre-K, mm-hmm. but a lot of them is seven through college, because people tend to forget about some of those kids who are moved on to college. They need some of the same necessities that maybe they wouldn't need as a freshman. So we focus on all of them. We have 13 different programs that we have throughout the Best of the Batch Foundation, and really we service 3,300 kids annually wow. in six different counties. So to see it grow to the levels that we are, we have a lot of
You're making a great
volunteer, great partners. It's just fantastic.
Key question, Charlie. Why do you do that? Why is it so important to give back like that?
Because I was one of those kids.
In what way?
And because literally where we grew up, people see the end result, and that's me as a professional football player, but they don't necessarily know the journey that it took to get there. So it's important for me to share that with them, to let them know the importance of hard work.
Oh, that's great. We're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we're going to have your Facebook question for Charlie.
Do you need a proven winner? Do you want to build a better team, create stronger leaders, and face change like a champion? Kurt David works with highly successful individuals, organizations, and businesses that at times face challenges with leadership, change, and developing passion. Go to KurtDavid.com and allow Kurt the opportunity to work with you.
Hi, I'm Kurt David, and our Facebook question today, Dan in Rhode Island wants to know, if you were to pick a quarterback in your fantasy football team, who would it be and why?
Wow. I mean, obviously this is a homer, but I would pick Ben Roethlisberger just because I see the work that he's putting in. Yes, they see the point where he is now. I mean, it's unbelievable because it took people this long to start giving him credit. And so he would be my guy that I would go with.
Wouldn't pick a Charlie Batch at all, or?
Well, I'm out now, so
oh,
I mean, if you're
okay.
talking about former fantasy league, then maybe, yes, but no, that's not the case.
So, Charlie, what's the best? I mean, you have the Impalia, the medical company. You have the speaking that you mm-hmm. do, the motivational speaking. You have the Batch Foundation. How can people get a hold of you? Where can they find out more information about those companies?
Actually, the people can go to charliebatch.com, made it simple. You can see everything that I'm doing throughout a calendar year, and I'll let you know some of my media obligations that I'm doing as well, because I'm doing color analyst for the first time this year for the Pittsburgh Steelers. I did during the preseason, and then I'll be part of the Steeler media team or radio broadcasting team.
This show is not simply about the transition of former professional mm-hmm. athletes, about transitions in life. What advice might you have for anybody that's going through a transition or change in their life?
Well, for me, I always kept it simple with the five P's. Proper preparation prevents poor performance. And if you prepare yourself, obviously you can set your mind to whatever you're trying to accomplish. So that was something that I've always done, even though I've continued to, I rode that wave of 15 years in the National Football League, but I never lost sight of the fact that one day it would be over.
No, appreciate you being on the show today, Charlie. That wraps up another show. Please join us again next time when we watch the stories of former professional athletes unfold from glory days.